I welcome all of you to the lecture on computational fluid dynamics. In the first 2 days of this 5-day workshop, Professor Puranik has built the foundation of this course, because when we proposed this course, we had little concern that we are not offering, we had offered a course on thermodynamics and heat transfer, and fluid mechanics is one of the prerequisite for taking up a CFD course. So we thought a lot about it, and in fact we were thinking to offer a fluid mechanics course, but it was not possible in a short notice. So Professor Puranik took the lead in building the foundation as far as fluid mechanics is concerned, and I could see that he has built the foundation quite well, and now he has made my life easy, and I can go a little fast in discussing the concepts of computational fluid dynamics. Now I'm talking to teachers, so let me share my experience of teaching CFD. I first started teaching this course after my master's. I was faculty in NIT Hamirpur. So I introduced this course to BTech students. At that time, they don't have any MTech students. So in 99, we introduced this CFD course as an elective course in the final year. And there I taught for 2 continuous years. And what I realized is that one of the common difficulty as far as this course is concerned, this course is struggling to become an undergraduate course in most of the colleges. You can see that CAD has gone into the undergraduate curriculum quite well, but CFD is still struggling to get into it. And another problem is many a times many of the colleges have a CFD course because they feel that there is a lot of importance and need of a CFD course, on where they don't have a trained faculty, and most of the time they use some software, and through software they feel that they are teaching CFD. If you look into the real learning or knowledge of CFD is concerned, market may have its own demand, but real learning involves using the concepts of fluid dynamics and trying to come up with a methodology, develop a numerical methodology for simulating heat transfer and fluid flow problem. So while teaching to the students, I had experiences in, I started my academic career from a private engineering college also, from after my BTech. So I have an experience of teaching different types of students. So that way I could judge the mathematical level of the students, which most of, let us say, colleges in our country have. So when I started teaching in here, I taught CFD course for the 4 years. I found that even the most of the students who take this course, this is an elective course, are the MTech students, and they also don't have a good mathematical background. So I came up with a new method in CFD, which we call as the physics-based finite volume method. So what I mean is that I can take an example. What Professor Puranik had mentioned earlier, he had mentioned that you can derive the Govan equations in fluid mechanics in 2 different ways. One way is that he took an integral equation and he used the Leibniz rule and the Gauss divergence theorem and showed how to derive the Govan equations. And at the same time, you may be knowing that there is a second method also to derive the equations, where what you do, typically that you do in the simplest form, in maybe in the first class of heat transfer, you take a control volume and you write left side Qx, Qx plus dx, Qy, Qy plus dy. So from that also you finally derive, let us say, del square T by del x square plus del square T by del y square. So from the control volume also you can derive the Govan equations. You can derive the Govan equations from, let us say, mathematically the way Professor Puranik had shown. So let me call the two procedure as mathematics based procedure, or the physics, and the control volume as the physics based procedure. If you go to CFD, all the books which you see in CFD, what they do is that they follow mathematical approach. They start with the governing partial differential equations. They do volume integral. For some of the terms which we know are surface terms, they apply Gauss divergence theorem and convert the volume integral to surface integral. When you teach the students in this manner, I had found at least that it's very difficult for the student to get the attention of the students. In fact, I was talking with one of the faculty Mr. Hegde yesterday evening, and he was saying that they have a CFD course, but students are not taking it. They feel that it's too mathematical. So with this series of lecture, my objectives, I would say that I would want to take out that barrier that it's too mathematical. Many time I use some mathematics, but I'll ask you whether this mathematics is very difficult. Whatever mathematics I will show you, it's very easy, very elementary. It's a school level mathematics. I would not talk about Gauss divergence theorem. So using minimum of mathematics, taking the help of the control volume, I had come up with what we call as the physics based finite volume method. But let me tell you, whether you follow this physics based or the mathematics based, which you see in all the CFD books, finally the end results which you get, what you get in the end results after the discretization, set of linear algebraic equations, those set of linear algebraic equations are same. So if the end product is same, whether you follow one path or the other path, one procedure or the other procedure, it doesn't matter. But what matters is that understanding which is involved. If while following a procedure you understand better, then you can take it forward. Okay, so all my lectures will be based on what I call as the physics based finite volume method, where we start with the control volume approach. It's good that Professor Puranik had given you a mathematical flavor of the course, and I would try to give a more of a physical behavior, physics based behavior of the fluid mechanics problem. So I'll start with the first part. First part is an introduction. I'll start with introduction to computational fluid dynamics, and then I'll also go to the introduction to fluid mechanics. Although Professor Puranik had taken fluid mechanics for 2 days, where he has laid down the foundation very well. However, I would like to show you a different flavor of the derivation, because this methodology is analogously used in the discretization finite volume method. Okay, so I'll show you control volume based derivation of the continuity equation and the transport equation. I'll also point out the initial and boundary conditions, which are very important as far as CFD is concerned. And then finally, I'll discuss the engineering parameters which you calculate. In any branch of science or engineering, whenever you do an investigation, there are basically two methods of investigation, I would say broadly: experimental and theoretical. And theoretical further can be subdivided as a computational and analytical methods. I typically start my lectures with a quote from Albert Einstein: "A theory is something which nobody believes except the person proposing the theory, and an experiment is something which everybody believes except the person doing the experiment." The reason I start with this statement is that you should pay particular attention to the first part of the statement. A theory is something which nobody believes except the person proposing the theory. Computational fluid dynamics is a theoretical method of investigation. So note that whether you are in academics or whether you are in industry, whenever you get some results, you have to convince people. You cannot just start discussing whatever results you have got. You have to convince people that you have used the software or CFD in a manner in which it is expected. What I mean is that you have to show what we call as in CFD language, code validation, grid independence, time independence, domain independence. You have to do a lot of other exercises to convince the people that you have followed the procedure properly. Because this CFD softwares are not like any other software which we have. Okay, so it has to be used properly, intelligently. Computational fluid dynamics, this is a subject which has grown. I would say these are the type of people who have contributed in its development: mathematician, computer science people, and the fluid dynamics people. And this fluid dynamics subject is not only limited to, let us say, mechanical engineering, but it is widely studied by various, not only in engineering but sciences, branches of engineering and sciences. So mathematicians have developed, as far as the algorithm development is concerned, let me tell you that the development of computational fluid dynamics depend lot on the hardware development. Okay, if you look into the history of CFD, the challenge we took as far as problem solution is concerned depends a lot upon the hardware. So the computer science people have contributed a lot into the hardware development. Mathematicians have contributed a lot as far as the algorithm developments are concerned. And I would say that the people from fluid dynamics area, they understand the physics of the fluid flow in a better way. Any mathematical procedure which you adopt, it has to have some physical basis. Otherwise, it will be just a numerical artifact. So that way, physical understanding has contributed a lot into proper development of proper mathematical procedure in the discretization. CFD, if you look presently, it is widely used in research organization. It is used in education a lot because there is a lot of need of this course as far as job is concerned. So as a teacher, there is in the field of education, we need to teach this course. This is widely used in industry, various industries, aerospace, biomedical, electronics, chemical industries, and so on. Although they wish to use as a design tool, but let me tell you, honestly, CFD has not reached to a stage where you can use it as a design tool. The only thing which is why we cannot use as a design tool is that it's very costly. Costly means cost in CFD means it takes a lot of computational time, and you need, let us say you want to do a real world simulation, you need parallel computing facility. If you have a parallel computing facility, you need AC. So there is a lot of cost involved as far as these computations are concerned. So if you want to use CFD as a design tool, you had to run many cases, many simulations, and that becomes too costly a procedure. So most of the time, if you look into the industry, I had been interacting with industry also in this regard. I had found that they use mostly this as a analysis tool. CFD is presently used by industry mostly as an analysis tool rather than a design tool. Although the wish list is they want to use it as a design tool. If you look into the development of CFD software, typically I will talk what happens in a traditional CFD books or courses, that they start with the governing partial differential equations and with certain set of boundary conditions, and they apply what we call as they convert the differential equations, because computer cannot solve the differential equation directly, because this system of equations are nonlinear systems and a coupled systems. So there is a method by which we convert this differential equation to an equation which computer can solve. And what is that equation? It's a set of linear algebraic equations. This method is called as the discretization method. In the early days of CFD, finite difference was the most popular method in CFD. But slowly, when people started solving more complicated problems, they realized that finite difference is good in Cartesian coordinate system, or let us say standard coordinate system. But they want to solve, when they want to solve the complex geometric problem, where the boundary are not aligned along the standard coordinate direction, then they felt that this finite difference method gives a lot of trouble as far as stability is concerned and accuracy is concerned. Numerical stability and numerical accuracy were the issues with which this motivated people to come up with a method which has a better conservations. You know, fluid mechanics is basically application of law of conservation of mass, momentum, and energy. So they came up with a method which I would call as a more of a physics-based method, where they ensured that the conservation laws are satisfied to a very large extent. So this finite volume method is more popular method, and if you look into the most of the CFD softwares, it is being used. Finally, once you get the set of algebraic equations, then there is a step back, because when you have set of, you have momentum, let us say continuity, momentum, energy, and so when you have a set of equations, you have to solve one at a time, because they are, many times you will see that they are coupled set of equations, and you need to develop a step-by-step procedure to solve the set of linear algebraic equation. That is what we call as the solution methodology. So this is one part of the CFD, but here I would say it's more of a, we start with equation and then we work it. I would say there is a parallel other development which needs to be done, where first part is, let us say, discretization of the equation. There is a second thing which needs to be done, which is called as the discretization of the domain. Okay. Like differential equation, we convert it into set of algebraic equation. Analogously, this continuous domain, in which we want to simulate. Okay, let me give you a slightly different flavor of CFD. How do you perceive CFD? What do you think, what is CFD? I would like to know from you, how do you, how each one of you would like to define CFD? What is CFD? You can be as simple as possible. So please raise your hand, we'll pass the mic, and let us try to develop a meaning of CFD, how each of one you perceive and feel about or understand about CFD. What do you feel, what is CFD? Please raise your hand.
It's a numerical tool to get an approximate solution of engineering problems.
Okay, good, next. It's a numerical tool to get an approximate solution of an engineering problem.
Sir, it is based on the principle.
Please. Continue.
It is based on the principle of divide and conquer.
Principle of?
Divide and fight.
I could not understand. Please.
Divide.
Divide and?
Fight.
Conquer. Okay. Yeah. Divide and rule, you are saying.
Yeah.
Okay. interesting. Yeah.
CFD is converting this partial differential equation into a set of algebraic equations to a discrete spaces, okay, and solving using some numerical methods.
Techniques. So he says that CFD is a numerical method where we do discretization and solve by some numerical methods. Any other definition anybody else would like to give? Do you think that this definition, when you go to the first class of CFD and if you give this definition, students will appreciate? I want some other definition. First class of CFD. Yeah. Because you have to excite student in the very first class.
It is an analysis tool which is used to solve the problem with the help of computer.
Okay. Okay, I think then here there is not much difficult languages for the first class introduction.
When fluid is in motion, we are predicting the flow parameters with the help of mathematical tools.
Okay, good.
It is the analysis of fluid flow or any component by using computers.
Okay.
More, all the definitions over, but one thing, we can visualize the flow in respect of various parameters. What actually happens in the flow, we can see it with the help of CFD.
Yeah, so I think at the last I had got very close to what I feel that could be the way of defining. I'll give you how I try to define the first class. I say that CFD is something by which you can create a movie. You say this word to the student, they will feel excited. You not only say this word, you show them some animation. You tell them you can create a movie out of CFD. But what movie? Not the movie which you see in theaters, but the what we call as fluid dynamics movie. Now tell them, now ask them, what movie is made up of? They will say movie is made up of pictures. If I want to create a fluid dynamics picture, how we should create a fluid dynamic picture? So they have some ideas. So they will say that flow we can, first thing they will say is that the flow we can create a picture in terms of velocity distribution, pressure distribution, temperature distribution. So I feel that you simplest way of defining CFD is CFD is like a tool by which you can create movies, fluid dynamic movies. Okay. Now, what they study in fluid mechanics and what they expect to study in CFD, let us say, this is a tool where we can create a fluid dynamic movie. You can give some more examples. Let us suppose some aeroplane is moving and you take a video camera and start creating a movie. Then the movie which you will create will not be a fluid dynamic movie. Okay, but just imagine let us suppose you have a fluid dynamic camera where you can create a movie, fluid dynamic movie. Then how it will look? You will zoom to some region in space, you will say. Okay, so you need some region to create a movie or one picture. So analogously in CFD, what do we have? We have a computational domain, region in space where you want to limit your picture. Okay. Then what a picture is made up of? What picture is made up of? Pixels. Analogously, here what we have? Grid points. Tell them that, okay, what is the specification of camera? They will say some megapixel. So here you say the resolution of the grid points. Here we also have certain resolution of the grid points. And if you want to purchase a camera of high resolution, the cost will be more. Here also, if you want to have more number of points, when more number of point, when the camera is of more pixels, then what happens? You have better clarity in the picture. Analogously, here you can say when the points are more, you get more accurate solutions. You can also give them the feel that it's not only the spatial discretization which matters, because in a picture, resolution, spatial resolution is good enough. But when you want to create a movie, there is a temporal resolution also involved, because in a movie there is a picture which is created with certain time interval. Okay, so what is the time interval between the two consecutive picture? The temporal resolution. So analogously, here in CFD we have certain time steps. Okay, so that way I think that if you try to explain them in this way, so then you can say that in CFD the objective of the course is not to create movies, but to teach how that CFD like camera is developed, how CFD softwares are developed. Okay, because there could be two parts of CFD. People can have a lot of discussion into this. There are two parts of CFD, CFD development and CFD applications. Most of the time it's easy to get started with CFD applications, because you take some software and start teaching through that software. It's easy to teach. But because it's like, as I say commonly, that it is easy to teach how to run a car as compared to how to build a car. Okay, so but I believe that as far as the teaching in CFD is concerned, the foundation is well laid if you teach them how the CFD softwares are developed. Okay, so when we talk of CFD software development, there are two levels of discretization: discretizations of the equations or discretizations of the conservation laws into set of algebraic equations. And the second is the discretization of the domain or the region in space where you are interested to obtain the results. So in the domain discretization, what we do is we convert the continuous, this domain has infinite number of points. We convert into analogously, you can call certain pixels or certain number of grid points. And the algebraic equations we get here consist the unknowns at this grid point. So if there are 100 points, let us suppose you are trying to create a fluid dynamic movie of flow across a car. So in the fluid region, let us suppose you enveloping the car, you pick up one region, and let us suppose you have 100 points distribution where more points are near to the surface of the car, then you get 100 algebraic equations. So whatever is the number of points which you have generated from the grid, the algebraic equation which you obtain, the unknowns in the algebraic equations corresponds to the value of the variables at those grid points. Okay, now once you generate the grid, as far as the linkage between the two is concerned, the coefficients which you have, this algebraic equations have certain coefficients, like if you talk of 3x plus 4y is equals to 5, so 3 and 4 are the coefficients of x and y. Okay, so the coefficient of this algebraic equation, what it consists of? Can anybody tell me what is the coefficient of, in a general language I want to know, what the coefficient of linear algebraic equation consists of? What? Yeah, please raise your hand, use mic, and then.
Magnitude, sir. Magnitude.
Magnitude of what?
Suppose if x is considered as a vector direction.
The coefficient of linear algebraic equation. Let us suppose there is a heat conduction problem. So the constants which we have, let us say 3T1 plus 4T2. So what that 3 and 4 is coming from? Where, from where it is coming from? Yeah. Please use mic.
The flow, mainly basically from fluid properties and the flow characteristics.
Fluid properties, correct?
Not boundary information, actually fluid properties, and then maybe the flow parameters.
Flow parameters, can you be more?
Like for example, heat conduction, it is the property of the material.
So it's basically like a thermophysical property you are saying. Properties. That is correct, but there is one thing more, I want to know that.
Geometrical parameters also.
Yes. Yes. So there are two things which comes to the coefficient. One is the thermophysical property, and second is the geometrical parameters. That is what I had written it here. Geometrical parameter means, let us say you divide, let us say this room I divide into certain cubes. Okay, this is a three-dimensional space. Let us say this is a three-dimensional Cartesian space. I divide into small cubes. So this cube, if you see a control volume, which you call in finite volume method, certain control volume has certain width, length, height, surface area, volume. All these are geometrical parameters. Okay, later on you will see that when we convert the conservation laws or the governing equation into algebraic equations, this will come as a coefficient. We will need this during our formulation. Okay, so this geometrical parameters as well as thermophysical property are the coefficients for the algebraic equation. So when you generate the grid, then you need to also calculate the geometrical parameters. So after CFD software development, I am talking here in a broader sense. I'll go into more specific details later on. In general, a CFD software consists of a preprocessor, solver, and a post-processor. In a preprocessor, basically you do the grid generation, calculation of geometrical parameters, and set the convergence criteria. Maybe you set some monitoring parameter, and then the solver, you basically select solution methodology, like semi-explicit explicit method or an implicit method, what type of convection schemes you are using. And then you solve. Let me tell you that this set of equations are solved iteratively. Once you solve, then you get the results. So once you get the result, then CFD analysis start, because when if you use a software, you will get a lot of results. So it is like you will have more food than what you can chew. Most of the time you have a lot of results, but you should be clever enough how to, what plots to generate, how to generate. So that, what I mean is that you, if you want to create a fluid dynamic movie, each one can you create a different, you can do a same simulation like flow across a car, all of you can do. But the movie, if I tell you each one of you to create a movie, fluid dynamic movie, each will create a different movie. But to create a good movie, you have to have proper zoom in, proper sections. If you want to understand fluid dynamics through a fluid dynamic movie, you have to be clever enough that you should understand that what type of plots I should generate. This is something which is called as a CFD analysis. Because if you can generate good plots, then pictures speak more than words. Animation speaks more than picture. Okay, like, you know, let me, as a teacher, I can also, here I would like to emphasize that as a teacher, you might have realized that if you want to teach some concept to the students, you always try, especially if you are working with blackboard, you always try to create some pictures, some cartoons to explain. Why? Why don't you use words? Because the pictures have more memory retention power. And nowadays, we have computers. So we can go one step ahead. From pictures, we can go to animation. And animation has one level more retention, memory retention power. And mainly nowadays students are quite excited about this technology, so you really need to excite them in different ways. In fact, I have a lot of interest in using education technology or animations in teaching. So you will see in this course that I use a lot of animations, not only PowerPoint animations, but to explain, especially teaching CFD is a challenge. Why? Because if you say that you have to divide a grid point, then you have to draw in a board domain, then you have to show, divide into certain control volumes, then you have to draw the grid points. If you do it manually in a blackboard, and I will show you how I will do it through animations. Okay. So if you do that, follow that procedure, there are two things. One is that you will not be able to cover too much of syllabus, first thing. Second thing is that you may not be able to, because students nowadays quite easily get bored. Okay, you might be seeing that in classroom teaching. The student, one of the problem is that they, you very easily lose the students, interest of the student. So you really need to be excite them, interact with them during the class hours. So I would strongly encourage all of you to use animations in teaching. Okay, so this post-processor, once you get a CFD simulation results, then you post-processing is basically generate proper results so that you can try to understand the flow situation in a better way. I am giving a general structure of a CFD software. If you want to apply, if you are using a software, then there is an initialization procedure, because if you are solving an unsteady state problem, it needs to have certain initial conditions. Then there are certain solution control, because here we solve iteratively, and then when you solve iteratively, you start with some initial condition. If it's a transient problem, then you do time marching. So there is a convergence criteria which you set up in your solution controls. And then once you, if you are running a, let us say, transient simulation, then you would like to monitor, let us say, velocity at some point, critical point. So there is some monitoring solutions which may be there. Like I think yesterday, one plot was coming after, let us say, n number of iterations. Then, so all this solution control, monitoring parameters you set, then the CFD calculation basically solver start working, and you monitor the convergence. So as we are solving iteratively, so what should happen is that after each iteration, there is some parameter which we call as the convergence parameter, which should reach to zero. If it reaches to the zero, means solution has converged and you should stop. But if it doesn't converge, then you need to modify your, let us say, you may have to do under relaxation, you may have to generate a better quality grid mesh. Okay, so it's not always necessary that you do a simulation and you get a converged solution. You may have to struggle with the mesh or the relaxation parameter, depending upon the problem. This is a general structure of CFD software. I would like to take you to a bigger picture of CFD. Now, we are talking of something, even if you look into the software products, it's not only CFD software. Now they are trying to combine CFD software with, let us say, solid mechanics software, and now it has become what we call as a multi-physics simulation. Okay. Now, I believe that we should move ahead from teaching CFD to a bigger thing, what we call as the CAE. So we should have a course, what we call as, right now we are struggling with teaching CFD, and now I'm trying to give you a vision that we should, in future, we should quickly try to teach what I call as a computer-aided engineering, which should have, because if you want to develop a computer-aided CAE expert, what is called a CAE expert, he needs to have expertise in solid modeling, FEM analysis, and CFD analysis. Let me tell you that as far as the CFD software development is concerned, they create products, they show capabilities. And right now I would say that the computational hardware have developed to a very good extent, and the industry is quite eager to use those hardwares for challenging problems. So there are a lot of challenging problems where we need, not only need knowledge of fluid mechanics, we need knowledge of, there is a fluid structure interaction problems, which needs knowledge of fluid mechanics as well as solid mechanics. So you see, there's not, now we have software which not only have the, let us say, have finite element method capabilities, mechanism analysis, and so on. So the bigger picture is that in academics, now we have to create CAE experts which should be taught solid modeling, FEM analysis, as well as CFD. In fact, in IIT Bombay, I, along with two other professors who are experts in finite element method and mechanism analysis, we had offered this course as a CEP course to industry and the academics. We had offered it 3-4 times. So the objective of this course is related with CFD. The objective is to develop an appreciation of the theory behind the computer screen. So whenever you use a software, there is some theory which is happening, let us say, behind the screen, which is applied behind the screen. So you should understand that so that you can use the CFD software more intelligently. I will draw your attention to some specific decision making when you are using a software in a simulation, and you have to appreciate the application of CFD. I'll discuss this with some example problems. So with this two approach of theory and application, I would here say that you will be firmly set to at least teach this course in your colleges in a better way. So this was all about the broader picture of CFD, where I would again highlight that CFD is like a tool. CFD is a tool by which you can create a movie, fluid dynamic movie. Okay, so as in a fluid dynamic movie, there are a lot of pictures. Picture is created in a space. So here there is a domain which is analogous to that. In a picture, there is a resolution, spatial resolution and temporal resolution. So here also you have certain spatial resolution and temporal resolution. But the good thing about the video camera is you just click and you get the movies. But here in this movie, even if you develop a tool, you have to keep running it in computers. And in most of the engineering problem, it takes a lot of time. You have to run days and nights, not only one processor, but multi-processor. They are hardware developed. We are aiming for what we call as the laptop parallel computing machines. Nowadays, another type of architecture, computer architecture, which has come, which is called as the GPU, graphics processing units. Okay, so the hardware people are trying to come up with a very heavy computations, laptops, let me tell you. So things are advancing in a hardware side, but if we train people who can use them in an intelligent manner, then only we will be able to really, because it's the man who has to do the things. So unless he is trained properly, all this hardware will not be able to utilize them in the best way. So after introduction to CFD, I'll go to introduction to fluid mechanics. This I'll do it really fast, as you had been taught the first 2 days on fluid mechanics. So, but I'll highlight, this was necessary for me because I take certain analogy for whatever I discuss here when I later on do the finite volume discretization. So in fluid mechanics, basically consists of this laws. These laws are called as conservation laws, law of conservation of mass, momentum and energy. This you may be knowing it since long, maybe from your first year of the college. And the whole, so the idea is that in fluid mechanics, we obtain certain mathematical models. And what are the mathematical models we obtain? Okay, now let me go to that picture or movie. Let me go back, as I said, that CFD tool by which you can create a movie. So to create a movie, what do you want? Let us say velocities, pressures and temperature. As a function of what? Space and time. So if you talk in mathematical language, how you can convert this into mathematical language? So you need some functions. There is some dependent variable as a function of certain independent variable. Okay, so what you want to achieve is that you want pressures, velocity as a function of more than one independent parameter, spatial coordinates and temporal coordinates. And when you want a functional relationship as a solution, then which mathematical model gives solution as functional relationship? You have different type of equations. Partial differential equations are the equations. Note that, what is the solution of algebraic equations? Numbers. What is the solution of differential equation? Functions. What is the solution of ordinary differential equation? Dependent variable as a function of one independent variable. When you have more than one independent variable, then you need a partial differential equation. So if you want to create a fluid dynamic movie, which type of equation you need? Partial differential equations. Although the partial differential equations are continuous in nature, their solution is continuous in nature. But we don't know the analytical solution of that. It's a $1 million problem. If you can obtain analytical solution for all the problems in fluid dynamics, Professor Puranik discussed few of the simple cases of exact solution of the Navier-Stokes equation. Fully developed flow in a pipe or a channel or but if you want to obtain analytical solution for a more general case, let us say flow in a turbine or a compressor, can you obtain analytical solution? If you can obtain analytical solution, all these CFD companies has to close down. It is as big as a problem like this. Okay. So analytical solution, I would say, is something like it is a camera which can create a movie which has infinite resolution. Because analytical solution has infinite resolution. Okay, because this is a continuous function. So here what we get is a discrete solution. We do not get functional relationship as a solution in CFD. We get solution as values at certain points only, not at all the points. So we apply this conservation laws, and there are two approaches in fluid mechanics. One is what we call as the differential approach, and second is the integral approach. In the differential approach, what we do is that we apply this conservation law to small regions, or what we call as a control volume. And in an integral approach, we apply this conservation law to some fixed finite region in space. And what we get from our differential approach is we get a differential equation, and from integral approach we get an integral equation. And the information which we get from this is also different. Differential equations can give you information by which you can create a movie. But in an integral equation will not give you information it gives certain engineering parameters. Like when jet strikes on a plate, which you might, simplest problem which you take in your UG fluid mechanics class. Do you get velocity distribution of the jet in integral analysis? What do you get? Force acting on the, which gives the gross parameter. The effect of that velocity and pressure distribution, the net effect is what you get from integral approach. So you get what you call as the gross information, not point by point information. In fluid mechanics, before going into the derivation, let me go to, because some mathematics will come, but let me start with the elementary mathematics, simplest of them. What is the simplest? This is the equation which I have written here, which is, I would say, that one of the simplest which you have studied in your schools. How do you express a partial derivative? Let us say del f by del x is fx plus delta x minus fx divided by delta x, limit delta x tends to 0. So let me say that suppose f is a flux. How do we define a flux? Flux is some term per unit area. As soon as you hear a term flux, it means this is a per unit area term. So let us suppose this small f is a flux. Okay. Now, when a term is per unit area, then if you take a control volume and this flux is directly proportional to surface area, then you should express this flux at surface areas. So if you take a, let us say, square control volume which I had shown here, how many surfaces it has? Two vertical surface, two horizontal surface. We are working in Cartesian coordinate system. Okay, then this flux is also certain direction. Okay, so and this fluxes we express in the normal direction. Right now I am talking in generic terms. I will be more specific later on when I take continuity equation, momentum equation, energy equation one by one. But what I am trying to tell you is that I am talking, starting with a generic, and then I will go to the specifics. So let us suppose there is a flux term. You can express it on the face acting in the normal direction. Now to get the total value of this flux, you multiply it by surface area. Here I am taking a 2D control volume. So the area perpendicular to the board, I am taking it as a unity. This width is delta x. So this surface area is delta x. This width is delta y. So this surface area is delta y. In the z direction, the dimension I am taking as unity. So by multiplying the flux with the surface area, we get the total term. In any conservation law, what I am trying to emphasize here is that you start with such pictures. What you do in heat transfer course? What is this F in heat transfer course? Small q, heat flux. When you apply law of conservation of mass, what is the small f? Mass flux. When you apply this momentum equation, what is this flux? Momentum flux. What is pressure? It's also a flux term. What is stress? It is also a flux term. So just think about this. Mass, heat, momentum, pressure, stress, all are flux terms. And this is what you have in fluid mechanics.
Sir, I got a question. You told that the stress is a flux.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate? Mass I am able to understand, momentum I am able to understand.
Correct.
Energy.
Okay.
But
how do you define stress?
Stress is force per unit area.
So there is a per unit area term.
Yeah.
So it's a flux. Anything which has per unit area term, I am defining it as a flux. So but stress is also force per unit area.
But the flux normally will say something which flows, no? One from one place to another place.
No. It's not. I'm saying here the definition. I'm saying it's anything which is per unit area. It's not flowing. It's not necessary. It's flowing.
Okay.
In CFD, many definitions change slightly. Let me tell you. Early, if you look into the fluid mechanics book, neostoke means only momentum. But in CFD, neostoke equation means also continuity and energy equation. So it just broadens slightly so that the generality comes up. Does this answer your question? Okay. So what happens is that in what I'm trying to tell you, the objective ultimately is to show that how we start from a control volume and obtain the differential equation. And what mathematics we will use? This mathematics. Is this very difficult for the student to understand? Okay, so and we do some conservation. Any conservation means what? Balance. In minus out or out minus in. So next thing what we will do is from this control volume we will do balance. Change of F. Now here I note that I am doing per unit volume. Why I am doing per unit volume? Can you tell me? Can anybody answer why I am doing per unit volume? I am doing a balance then per unit volume. Please use mic.
So as to make it dimension independent.
No, it's not.
So as to accommodate the flux.
No, it doesn't become non-dimensional. Even if you make it per unit volume, it doesn't become non-dimensional. Because if you balance mass flow rate per unit volume, let us say if you do, it does not become non-dimensional. There is some other reason. What you want to achieve a partial differential equation. Can you achieve this partial differential equation without dividing by volume? You have total term. What is total term? Flux multiplied by surface area. What is flux? Flux multiplied by surface area divided by volume. Flux multiplied by surface area divided by volume will give you a length scale in the denominator. And if you need a derivative, you need a length scale or a delta x, delta y, or delta t in the denominator. How can you get? If you don't divide by, you are doing balance of fluxes. When you are doing balance, you are multiplying by surface area. If you want elemental length scale in the denominator, you have to divide by volume. That is the reason we are doing it divided. What I mean is that this is multiplied by delta y. When I divide by volume, this will become delta x in the denominator. In the next slide, you will see. So if I don't divide by volume, I will not be able to convert into differential terms. This is the simple mathematical reasons for dividing by volume. This reason is only mathematical. There is no physical reason for it. Is that clear? Any question into this? This is the basic slide. This I will do first for mass conservation, second for momentum conservation. Momentum conservation, this I will do at different terms. In energy equation also, this is done many times. But if you understand this, is this mathematics any difficult? Do you feel you will find it difficult for the student to grasp this mathematics? Okay. So this is what I said just now, that what is different F term, capital F term, total term, and what is small F term. In the mass conservation, small m is mass flux. In the momentum conservation, there is a x momentum flux. This I'll discuss in more detail later on through some animations. Not only momentum flux, but the stresses. When we talk of stresses in fluid mechanics, there are two types of stresses. One is pressure and second is the viscous stresses. Similarly, you have y momentum flux and the stresses in the y direction. And in energy equation, you have enthalpy flux and conduction heat flux. This enthalpy flux is a product of mass flux into specific heat into temperature. This mass flux is mass flow rate per unit area. Okay. And the total F term are mass flow rate, x momentum rate, force in x direction, y momentum rate, force in y direction, enthalpy rate, and conduction heat transfer. In fact, if you see these three slides, I believe that the student, if he thinks really, he should be able to derive all the equations. However, I will show you the detailed derivation one by one quickly to make it more clear, more explicit. I'll start with the derivation of continuity equation. What is that? Rate of change of mass of the fluid inside and across a control volume is equal to zero. This I am doing it for an incompressible flow and without any mass source. So wherever there was F, I am writing it small m, which is mass flux. This is the mass inflow, this is the mass outflow. Is zero. So you see, this is the rate of change of mass inside the control volume. What is this rho density? This is a 2D control volume. What is the volume delta x into delta y? So what is this product? Mass. If you take a time derivative, it is rate of change of mass. The rate of change of mass, and this is net outflow. Net, so this comes out like this. This is the mass, net mass going out of the control volume. And when you divide by the volume, you get this term. This is the derivation of continuity equation. I would like to mention that when we do this derivation, there are two stages of derivation. In the first stage, you get first derivative of flux. And in the second stage, you get second derivative of, like in conduction, what happens? First, you get equations such as del qx by del x plus del qy by del y. There, f is qx, qy. Okay. This completes the first stage of derivation, I would say, where you get first derivative. Then in the second state, what you do? Heat flux is non-measurable quantity, you convert it in terms of temperature. There you used one law which is in fluid mechanics or heat transfer, you call it as a subsidiary law. What is that law? Fourier law of heat conduction. Qx equals to minus k dt by dx, and when you substitute that, you get a second derivative. Here in this case, you don't get a second derivative. Why? Because Q is expressed in terms of gradients of temperature, but the mass flux is expressed in terms of normal velocity, not as a gradient, but in terms of, what is mass flux? Density multiplied by normal velocity, not the gradient of velocity. Okay, note this. Because in CFD, we need to develop approximation for the gradient or the value depending upon the flux. When you go to the derivation of the transport equation, there are, I would initially start with the physical description. This, what I would do is that the momentum equation and energy equation, I will derive under a single umbrella, which I call as the transport equations. This is what you will see in many of the chemical engineering books, but not so common in mechanical engineering or let us say civil engineering. Because if you look into the mechanism of this heat and momentum transport, it's basically a like a transported variables. There are two types of transport mechanisms. One is the diffusive transport, second is the advective transport. What is the diffusive transport? This occurs by the random motion of the molecules. What happens in conduction? This diffusive transport gives which type of heat transfer? Conduction. And what is the advective transport mechanism? Not only the molecules move, but as a group also they move. So there is a bulk or macroscopic motion. Okay, so there are large number of molecules move collectively. But when the large number of molecules are moving collectively, there is a random motion also inside that collective motion. This molecular heat flux, which occurs due to random motion of molecules, contributes only to conduction heat transfer. Whereas this molecular momentum flux, this results in pressure and viscous forces. I think in the previous lecture, Professor Puranik has asked you that from molecular level, how pressure is generated. So there is a rate of change of momentum of the molecules tracking from kinetic theory of gases. this viscous forces also are generated due to random motion of the molecules. When you have collective motion and there is a velocity or temperature gradient. Temperature gradient means non-isothermal flow. So if it's a non-isothermal flow and if there is a motion, then it contributes both to heat and momentum transport. So these are the two transport mechanisms. Now I'll show you some animation. Let us suppose you are standing between ice at 0 degree and fire at 100 degree centigrade. This is just to give you a feel of the different mechanisms. If you are sitting exactly in the middle between ice and fire, and if there is no flow, and let us assume that the heat transfer is one dimensional, okay, one dimensional in the z direction, heat transfer is one dimensional, there is no flow. No flow means no collective motion of the molecule. I am making an assumption. If you are standing exactly in the middle, what temperature you will experience? Which phenomena here is occurring? Pure diffusion phenomena, and that too one dimensional. So the average is you will experience a temperature of 50 degrees centigrade. So this is a pure diffusion phenomena. Here we are talking for conduction, but conduction is easy to, heat is easy to feel and understand and absorb. But the same thing happens in fluid flow as well as, what I mean is that here it's a conduction heat transfer. There it causes the viscous forces. Okay, now let us assume that the flow velocity is very large, and the flow is from the ice side with a very large velocity. What is the temperature which you will experience? Close to 0 degree centigrade. And if the flow is very large from the fire side, then you experience close to 100 degree centigrade. I am emphasizing this word close to. Why? Because conduction is negligible as compared to advection. What I am saying here is that I am trying to create a situation which I want to call as a pure advection. Pure conduction is a reality. Pure advection is a approximation. What I want to tell you is that when flow takes place, random motion molecule will anyway be there, so conduction will anyway be there. But if I want to have pure advection, then I have to make conduction negligible. When can it become? If the flow velocities are very large. The real world situation is something like this. If the flow velocity is, let us say, 1 meter per second, you experience a temperature of 40 degree centigrade. And if it increases to 100 meter per second, maybe you experience a temperature of 10 degree centigrade. So you are not experiencing 0, 100 or mean. The value not depends upon the magnitude. When the flow is from the fire side at 1 meter per second, let us say that you assume it, you feel a temperature of 60, and when it is 100 meter per second, you experience a temperature of minus 90. Let me tell you, this understanding is used in CFD. So it's not mathematics. It's a physics. This is what you feel. If whatever example I am giving, you are able to understand and appreciate. So when you are teaching CFD, if you start with physics and then go to mathematics, and that to try to keep mathematics as low as possible, which I always try, then I think you can make the student feel that this course is not quote unquote mathematical. Okay, so just note this slide. I will come back to this slide when I will be teaching advection schemes. You might have heard in if you are using software, first order operand scheme, second order, quick scheme, power law scheme, all those schemes are designed from this understanding. Now I will quickly show you the derivation of the transport equation, law of conservation of momentum, energy. law of conservation of, what I'm doing is that these are specific statements and I am combining the statement as a transport equations. Rate of change of momentum of fluid inside and across the control volume. Let me tell you that this laws, momentum equation is basically coming from which law? Newton's law of motion, Newton's second law of motion. This law was proposed for Lagrangian or for Eulerian? This was expressed for, this was proposed for fixed mass or fixed region? Fixed mass. So it was original, even you teach fluid mechanics, you convert that total derivative as two component, as temporal and convective component. Okay, so initially it was proposed for a fixed mass. So what I am trying to tell you is that right now we are, I think it is for fixed mass, but when we follow an Eulerian approach, it will have two components, which I will discuss little later. For energy equation, it is the rate of change of internal energy or of enthalpy of the fluid inside the control volume, across the control volume. So these two statements I can combine and write a simple expression. And this is rate of change is equal to pressure, some force basically. So there are different types of forces we have in fluid mechanics. In general, we classify into two types, surface force and body force. So the surface force are the viscous force and the pressure force, and the body force is like gravitational or due to magnetism or the electric field. And this rate of change of internal energy is equal to heat gained by conduction and volumetric heat generation. This also can, these two statements can also be combined into a single statement, saying that the rate of change of momentum or energy of the fluid inside and across due to across happens due to advective transport is equal to momentum or heat gained by molecular transport and volumetric source term. So we use a general transport equation which is applicable both for momentum as well as energy equation. Now how we can write rate of, now what, let me point out that I am showing you the derivation, but this derivation is different from what Professor Puranik had shown you. Here I am showing you from control volumes, not from the integral form and using the Gauss divergence theorem and Leibniz rule. Rate of change of, okay, let us look into this. What is this? Density multiplied by volume is mass. Mass multiplied by u velocity is x momentum. We are interested in rate of change of x momentum. So when you want to rate, you take a time derivative. So this is rate of change of x momentum. This is rate of change of y momentum. This is rate of change of enthalpy. Okay, so this is the way you can express words to differential terms directly. Let me point out that I am not writing as x, this I am not writing as t plus delta t minus t divided by delta t. I am not applying limit anything like this here, because this rate of change I can express directly as a derivative. I don't think it's mathematically too complex to understand and appreciate. Rate term anyway, we can like a temporal derivative. So that was the first unstudied term. As I said that this rate term was proposed for a Lagrangian system. In a Eulerian system, there are two components. One inside the control volume, and second, when the flow is occurring across the control volume, there is some momentum change across the control volume. So this is the second component of the unstudied term. What is this? What is F here? If you go back to the earlier slide, I had shown F multi, so F into delta Y. What is F here? F is here product of M and U. What is M? M is mass flux. What is U? U is velocity in the x direction. What is mass flux? Mass flow rate per unit area multiplied by u velocity. Mass flow rate into u velocity is what? Momentum rate, x momentum rate. U velocity means x momentum rate per unit area. When you multiply it by area, what does this term represent? What is the total F term? Mass flow rate multiplied by, sorry, mass flux multiplied by area is mass flow rate. Mass flow rate multiplied by velocity is momentum, x momentum rate, and this is your x momentum flux entering, leaving. This is similar to what you do in your conduction class, a qx, qx plus dx. What is, instead of small q here, you have m into u. What is m into u? X momentum flux. This is y momentum flux. Where is v velocity? U y, I am using a symbol v for velocity. What I mean by u y is u at a location y. Don't confuse with the symbol, u at a location y. Like you write q y, but actually in that case q y is not only in the at y, but it also in the normal direction. I understand that this is difficult to get a feel, that I am saying that the mass flow rate in the y direction is multiplied by u velocity. This is a little difficult to get a feel, I understand that. But this is not, this is mass flux multiplied by area as a scalar. Okay. Mass flow rate into u velocity. So the direction of this is decided by the direction of this u velocity. Mass flow rate into u velocity is still a x momentum. So this is the x momentum entering from the bottom wall. This is the x momentum entering from the left wall. And this is the x momentum leaving from the top wall. And then again you balance it and divide by volume and you get this. Basic definition of a differential term is used here. Same thing you do in, so wherever there was u, I am writing v, and I get. So let me tell you, in conduction, what do you get? Del by del x of qx plus del by del y of qy. In case of continuity, what do you get? Del by del x of mx plus del by del y of my. Here, what you are getting? For x momentum, you got del by del x of mxu plus del by del y of mxu. Sorry, myu. For y momentum equation, wherever there is u, you get v. Del by del x of mxv plus del by del y of myv. Note this, this is like a, I say that if you want to get more understanding of this, when you talk of advection, there are two types of variable. One is the advecting variable, which is like a driver. And second is what we call as the advected variable, which is like a passenger. So when you talk of advection, there are two things, two variables, two dependent variables. In fact, where non-linearity comes in fluid mechanics? In advection. Because there are two dependent variables which are multiplied. Which are those two? Mass flux, which consists of which velocity? Normal velocity, surface normal velocity. And second is the, like in this case, the second velocity is the v velocity. This consists of one velocity. This mx is rho u. What is this my? Rho v. So we have product of two dependent variables, which makes it nonlinear. Okay, so which one is driver in this case and which one is like a passenger? What do you feel? Which is driving? Mass flow rate. Mass flux is driving the flow, and which is going along with the flow is u velocity in the x momentum equation, v velocity in the y momentum equation. Let me tell you this, momentum in general, it varies from point to point, it's a vector equation, but here we are resolving into component, that's we are saying that, but strictly speaking, it is easy to understand and appreciate this advection in energy rather than in momentum, because momentum, what happens is a vector quantity. When you go to the conduction or energy equation, you only have temperature, then it becomes little easier. I will go to the next slide, go to the energy, then maybe you can appreciate in a better way. So what is the difference here? What is the small f in this case? Mass flux multiplied by specific heat multiplied by temperature. What is this? Enthalpy flux. So you get similar equation. Okay, so earlier we have del by del x of mxu plus del by del y of myu for x momentum. Here we have del by del x of mxcpt. Here again this mass flow rate is the driver and temperature is like a passenger. In CFD, what we do is that rather than writing, if we have common things, we try to commonalize things. We want to write subroutines with general variables. So what you can see in this case is that although I had this advection as a momentum flux in x momentum, y momentum flux in y momentum, and enthalpy flux in the energy equation. But the nature of the differential equation is very much similar. Later on, I'll show you like a fill-in-the-box type of problem. So we write one subroutine with general variable. Instead of writing u velocity, v velocity, or temperature, we define a general advector variable called as phi. And we write a general subroutine in terms of phi. When I have to calculate x momentum flux, I call that subroutine where I send u velocity for phi, v velocity when I want y momentum flux, and temperature when I want enthalpy flux. I can define a constant c, which is 1 in case of momentum, and c is 1 for momentum and is equal to specific heat for energy equation. So that way I can generalize, we can generalize. So here, what is A? A is the momentum flux in momentum equation and enthalpy flux in energy equation. And this is the general form of the equation. I will show you more. So this is general form of the advection flux. What is advection flux? X momentum flux in x momentum equation, y momentum flux in y momentum equation, and enthalpy flux in energy equation. And this is the way when you balance it and divide by volume, you get this type of terms. And as I said that you can have a general variable phi. Phi represents basically the passenger, which I called advected variable, which is u velocity for x, v for y, and temperature for momentum equation. As I said that this c is a one unity for momentum equations and specific heat for energy equation. So with this, I had shown you advective transport mechanism from a control volume, how you can obtain first derivative. Note that in advection, you don't get second derivative. Why? Because this fluxes, here what flux we have? Momentum flux or enthalpy flux. Enthalpy is not expressed in terms of gradients of temperature. It is expressed as value of temperature. Note that. Because later on, this fluxes, when we discretize in CFD, we will need the value or the gradient at phase center.